Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. A very good morning and welcome to St. Colmanel's Church of Hockwell. Good to see so many of you out this morning. If you're new or a visitor, you're especially welcome, and make sure you say hello to me and introduce yourself on the way out. I want to just say quickly a massive thank you, first off, for the wonderful decorations around the church. I think you'll agree our new church has been splendidly decorated this morning, a real example of a display of nature, so it's really lovely. And it's a great team effort when our volunteers come together on a Saturday morning and give over their valuable time to make our church look so well. So thank you so much to the team of volunteers who do this for us. Thank you. Thanksgiving, we know, should be at the heart of our Christian journey. It should be the foundation upon which we do life. Every one of us has a different set of circumstances, a different journey to walk. We have a different path, each one of us, and each one of us have different hurdles, different difficulties to deal with. When we are finding life the hardest, we definitely can find it very difficult to be thankful. But it is a wonderful practice to keep in our lives, and it is a strong foundation for doing life. When we remember how God has so wonderfully blessed us, it can powerfully help us strive forward in faith. The psalm on screen, let's read verse. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. We are commanded to continually remember, hold before us the blessings that are before us. And you may have noticed in life that all of us, everyone, worships something. In the secular world, whether they're anywhere near religious faith or anything, they're still worshiping things in life, chase after things. We live for things and we strive for things. But when we strive for, live for the gifts of God instead of the gift giver, then we are in a difficult position. The blessings that we all enjoy can become the focus without a thought for the one who blesses us, who provides the blessing. So as a Christian, we are to hold the Lord God and all the blessings he pours upon us at the centre of our lives. And then we can handle hurdles. This time of year, we traditionally give thanks for the harvest, for the food that we enjoy, that our countryside and our country provide, and that we enjoy and often take for granted. So I'm going to invite us to stand. There's a few prayers on screen which are focused on this sort of thankfulness as we begin. So we remember those who work hard for us. Lord, we remember, we give thanks for farmers who plough and sow, who tend and reap their crops and care for their flocks and their herds. For this we say together,
God, we give you thanks and bless your holy name.
Lord, we remember fishermen and seafarers who bring food from far off places.
God, we give you thanks and bless your holy name.
For bakers and producers, drivers and traders who fill our shops with food.
God, we give you thanks and bless your holy name.
For workers in industry and commerce who keep things going in businesses, who use technology to provide us with goods and services.
God, we give you thanks and bless your holy name.
And finally, Lord, we simply thank you for the gifts of soil and seeds, sunshine and rain, and the miracle of life and growth.
God, we give you thanks and bless your holy name.
Let's remain standing and sing our opening hymn of thankfulness. You're the work of God the Father.
Thank you.
be seated. Nice joyful one to get us going there this morning. Folks, you should have received a notice sheet or seen it in your pews there. Take that home with you. And if you have a neighbour or someone you know who's connected to the church but not attending, please pass that on to them. That lets us know, gives everyone a warning what's up ahead in October and beyond. So please keep a wee eye on that. This is our Harvest Sunday service, of course, today. And this evening we have an evening service, 6 p.m. here in St. Colmenels. The Reverend Peter Smith is coming to preach for us. He's the rector of Loch Golden Grange in Armada's Isles. Peter's a good friend of mine. He trained with me. If you ask him a few stories after, or ask him a few questions after a tea and coffee, you might find out something I don't want you to know. But he is he loves outreach. He loves reaching people with God's word. And he's got a powerful testimony himself, which he is going to be sharing with us as well. So I encourage you to come along and enjoy that. And as I say, tea and coffee available afterwards as always. You're most welcome. Our Bible study is on again this week, Tuesday night, in the cabin, 8 p.m. Just to say, we had our trip to Connor, Texas Castle yesterday, down in Castle Ellencastle. We had a wee group who were there for the day. But I have to say, it was a wonderful event. Over 100 children praising God together, having fun together as well. But a powerful day was had, and our wee group did very well. It's quite humbling for me as well. I think it was the first time I've been referred to as an old man. I was holding onto a phone for a young girl, and then she couldn't find me afterwards, and she said to her leader, "It was just, I gave it to some old man." And I said, "Yeah, that was me." So it can be humbling, but a true blessing to be alongside wee people taking the Lord God seriously in their lives. It's a lovely thing to be part of, and a wonderful fellowship. Our harvest collection, including our loose plate collection at the back there throughout October, will be going towards Eva Diocese, especially their training centre, where they train young people to in joinery, electronics, and now welding skills. So they need power supplies, they need new tools and fresh tools and things like that. So we want to support them in that. Many of you maybe have harvest standing orders as well for this season. If you don't, there is white envelopes as well if you want to have them registered under your name, under your number, for example. Speak to Greer if you would like an envelope to put your collection through in that manner. What's next there? Yes, our shoebox appeal. Our shoeboxes will be available from next Sunday onwards, so you can collect them next Sunday and leave them back. And again, last Sunday being the Sunday the 3rd of November. Our contribution to that charity, which is a great charity, which spreads this wee gift around the world, has the gospel within it, but they are treats for young people around the world. Our contribution to that has been growing every year. We have been more and more generous, it seems, especially since COVID times. So I hope that continues, and it's a wonderful charity to be supporting. And if you have any queries or questions, you can speak to Gillian Moody as well about that. Final announcements. We are doing a wee resource called Hope Explored, and we're holding it in Mary and Martha's in the town, and thank you to Donna in advance for hosting that for us. It's just on 3 Wednesday nights between the 16th and the 30th of October. I want to ask you to contact me if you want to attend, because we have limited spaces, and we're also aiming at those folk who maybe aren't part of a regular Bible study at the minute. Who maybe find themselves a wee bit in the fringes, aren't on a Bible study, or maybe even not in a clear fellowship within the church. So that's who we're aiming for first. So if you're interested, come along. It's a really easy thing to go to. There's a wee video and there's a chat afterwards, and it's good fellowship together. And it's really exploring what is a Christian faith in a wee simple format, and it gives everyone the opportunity to ask those questions that you never feel like an ask on a Sunday that are burning within us. So if you're interested, please speak to me, and we'll get you on the list. So that is it for announcements. Again, take the notice sheets, take them home, put them on the fridge, and keep up to speed with all that's going on. We say sorry, don't we, every time we gather together for worship. We remember that we have a good and a holy God who we want to serve and who asks us to be holy in our lives, and yet we know we fall short. Our confession, our seeking of forgiveness is based around, we're thinking about creation, we're thinking about the big harvest that God has given us all and how we treat it. So let us confess our sins against God and man's kind's abuse of his creation. So Lord, we seek forgiveness for when we demand cheap food without thought of the well-being of the growers, the farm animals, or even the land itself. For this we say, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, we ask forgiveness for when we fail to consider those who produce our food in difficult conditions and often for modest rewards. For this we say, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, we seek forgiveness for when we forget to simply give thanks to you for our good food, for our clean water. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy upon each one of us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I am very thankful for the many volunteers in both churches who do so much that it's too much to start mentioning, otherwise you start to get into bother. But there's a wee note in the back of the notice sheet, and I put it in the last one as well, just about opportunities to volunteer for your church. If you find yourself with a bit of time in your hands, I know many of us struggle with that, but if you have a bit of time, we do have this policy, every little helps. If there's some way in which you can support your church through volunteering, you'll be most welcome to do so. And I'm always grateful for our people who do kids talks for us as well. I think it's so important that as a church we show our children that it's not just the weird guy with a collar that talks about all this Jesus stuff, but actually there's other adults, there's other parents who take God seriously and take the Lord Jesus seriously in their lives. And I think that is wonderful when we have leaders who volunteers willing to do that. And sometimes they even do a double shift for me. Sometimes they do it in Portland on and here. So I'm thankful for Patricia today, who's going to give us our kids talk this morning. So Patricia, is that too much of a build up for you, Patricia?
Amazing. I was at home and I was thinking, what am I going to talk about? Like, there's only so much you can say about a carrot and a couple of spuds. You know, saying that, I am really grateful for them and thankful for them. And I stared at the word and I thought, actually there's quite a lot of good words you can make out of the word harvest. And if you have a wee look at it, can any of you see any words? Anybody show you any words you can make out of the word harvest?
Yes.
Anybody else?
Yes.
Yeah. There's actually quite a lot of them.
Oh,
Anita, before she went on holidays, I thought, I'll ask Anita, she's got a good head on, and I says, give me a word out of harvest that I could talk to you about in church, and she went, vest, and I thought, just you go on your holidays. There's four words I'm going to talk about. The first word is have. Look at what we have. Take a look at ourselves, I mean, we're all really well dressed. Look at the church, isn't it beautiful? Look at all the fruit and the veg. Look, we've got a choir, we've got musicians, we've got a congregation, we've got a minister, we've got a church, and we've got a great big God. And I think firstly we should give a round of applause for all that. Secondly, the word I see, sadly, is the word starve. And as much as we have plenty, there's people in this world and they're actually starving. They're starving of food. They're starving of just all the stuff that we have. But they're also starved of God because they're not allowed to worship, they're not allowed to have Bibles, they're not allowed to profess their faith. And we can't forget those people. The third word I see is the word share. And when you look at all the fruit and the veg and everything around here, tomorrow morning it's all going to be bagged up, it's going to be sent out, it's going to be shared throughout the community. And I think that's brilliant. But as much as all the fruit's shared, there's stuff we can share. We can share the fruits that we have. We can share our time, our talents. We have plenty. I don't for 1 minute think we just have one of everything. We have loads. The fourth one I can see is the word heart. And we've each and every one of us has got one of them. All in different sizes, but that's entirely up to yourselves. In your heart, there's seeds that God planted there. There's two things. Did you plant your seeds, or do you plant your seeds in the soil? Or do you plant your seeds in the rock? When you plant your seeds in the soil, you need water. You need to read your Bible. You need to come to church. You need to actually be good, be kind. Be as like God as you can be. Here's a wee example of this. I need a wee helper. Any wee helpers worth? Want to come up and... I can see a wee hand somewhere there. Mona! Oh, both of you's brilliant. Because you're both going to have to carry that. What's your name?
Sean.
Hello, Sean. And what's your name? I think Sean. When you helped me the last time, and that was a full year ago. Right, just want to turn around to the congregation. Right, and would both of you try and hold this together, right? So here's me. I wanted it to be a nice thin banana, but it didn't work. So here's me, a wee round orange. I've got the armour of God on. I've got my sword, I've got my shield, I've got my belt, I've got my helmet. Because I want to plant my seeds in the soil. I want to be like God. So whenever I get into deep water, look what happens. I float. Do you know why? Because God's carrying me. And that's exactly in life what I want. Then, there's the other people. And they're just the same as me, because I ain't perfect. But they can't be bothered with God. And sadly, they think they can do it on their own. And this is a harder orange to peel than the one I hadn't put on. And look, they don't be bothered with the armour of God. They do their own thing. Look at me, I'm the boy. Look, and whenever they get in a deep water, look what happens. But I saw you. Straight down to the bottom. Sink and burn. That's what happens. They think they don't need God. My question to you is, which one do you prefer? So just as I leave this morning, thank you kids, that was a great job. Just want to go and sit down before I've been ringing. Lastly, as I finish, just remember these four words. The first one is, look at what we have and be thankful. The second one is, share what we've got, because we've got plenty. The third one is, look at what's in our hearts and do we water them. And lastly but not least, let's never forget those who starve. Amen.
Thank you, Patricia. I'm just going to pray for our young people before they head out to continue worship down the road. Let's pray. Lord, we're thinking about your gifts, and we want to be thankful for the gift of our children, the blessing of family. And we thank you for the young people that you have blessed us with. And we ask that you help us, Lord, really guide us as we care for them, as we guide them to look to you in their lives. Help them know that you are there to go to live for, and that when we trust in you, you turn up and you guide us. So, Lord, we pray for our Sunday school and YF leaders. May you bless them and bless our young people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So Michael's going to play as our young people head down the road there for worship. Thank you. collect for today, for this harvest season. Let's, eternal God, you crown the year with your goodness and you give us the fruits of the earth in their season. We ask you grant that we may use them to your glory for the relief of those in need and for our own well-being. We ask this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I mentioned about being thankful for volunteers, very thankful for our choir and all the work that they put in. So we're going to enjoy some of their fruit from their labours recently as they sing for us. Great is thy faithfulness. He has always been faithful. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you very much. We'll invite Jennifer now for our scripture reading. We continue in the Gospel of St. Luke. We're into chapter 7. You can find that on page 1035 of the Pew Bibles if you wish to follow.
The Faith of the Centurion. When Jesus had finished saying all this in the hearing of his people, he entered Capernaum. There a centurion servant, whom his master valued highly, was sick and about to die. The centurion heard of Jesus and sent some elders of the Jews to him, asking him to come and heal his servant. When they came to Jesus, they pleaded earnestly with him, "This man deserves to have you do this, because he loves our nation and has built our synagogue." So Jesus went with them. He was not far from the house when the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, don't trouble yourself, for I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. This is why I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you. But say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes. And that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd following him, he said, "I tell you, I have not found such great faith, even in Israel." Then the men who had seen, who had been sent, returned to the house and found the servant well. Jesus raises a widow's son. Soon afterwards, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went along with him. As he approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the town was with her. When the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her, and he said, "Don't cry." Then he went up and touched the coffin, and those carrying it stood still. He said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." The dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. They were all filled with awe and praised God. "A great prophet has appeared among us," they said. "God has come to help his people." This news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jennifer. Our psalm for today is a psalm of giving thanks. And I'm going to invite us to stand. We're going to say this in alternate half verse. "Be joyful in the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness.
And come before his presence with song.
Know that the Lord is God. It is he that has made us, and we are his.
We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Give thanks to him and bless his name.
The Lord is gracious. His steadfast love is everlasting.
And his faithfulness endures from generation to generation.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Amen.
Just in verse 4 of that psalm, we are reminded, the Lord's steadfast love endures forever. That means there is no limit, there's no end to God's love. We can't find ourselves in a place where we're not going to get the forgiveness that we need because we don't go to him. The Lord's love is everlasting, and there's no end to it. Let's stand, or remain standing, and sing our next hymn together. "Come Ye Thankful People, Come."
Thank you.
We thank you. We are to be thankful today. We know that we should be thankful throughout our whole lives. But Lord, as we try and focus today especially, may we draw close to you. May you speak to us through the Holy Spirit, through our hearts, through our minds. May we draw closer to you in this life and know what it is to follow and to be thankful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. I had to watch where I put down my clicker there because there's good knocks and fruit over. Just be easy, be handy. Up here. My very first sermon that I ever did from a pulpit, I don't know how well, I didn't do any other sermons, was back in 2011. First time from the live studio audience. And it was a Sunday evening service in St. John's in Moira. And there was maybe just 20 odd in the congregation. And I preached on Luke chapter 7 on the centurion's servant. Nervous as you get out, as I was. I had no idea how I would get through it, but I managed it. And my live studio audience were very grateful, or graceful, I should say. They weren't grateful, they were graceful. They didn't walk out or laugh in the wrong places or anything like that. They kindly sat through it for me and offered me some encouragement on the way out the door. One person said, "Well done, you got through it." Another person said, here you would know you were nervous up there." But I was happy with that. I can't remember any screwed up faces or shaking of heads or even anyone falling asleep. So that was good for me. And that was all going to come later, of course, you know. Plenty of that down the line. Don't worry, I'm not going to repeat that sermon. I wouldn't do it to you. I couldn't find it if I tried, and you wouldn't want to hear it. We are continuing through Luke's Gospel today. We know that over the last few weeks we've been talking about Luke. We know we feel that it's probably true that he was a Gentile, and he wrote this letter for a Gentile audience, a non-Jewish audience. And this character, the Roman centurion, is the first main character who is a Gentile, a non-Jew, that he is dealing with in this passage. So let's look at it afresh together. So those first couple of verses there are from verse 2 that Jennifer read first. "Now a centurion had a servant who was sick and at the point of death." Another wee sign that Luke was a doctor, possibly, you know, that he's able to distinguish that description. This person was at the point of death. He'd maybe seen this before in other people. "A centurion had a servant who was sick at the point of death, who was highly valued by him," by the centurion. "When the centurion heard about Jesus, he sent elders of the Jews asking him to come and heal his servant." So it's a pretty straightforward, you might think, situation. We can imagine we have a sick servant, we have a very concerned boss, and we have a request to Jesus for help. Jesus, this miracle healer that everyone is talking about, a straightforward setting. But let's just first pick up on a few things at this moment. First of all, this is Israel, but it is under Roman occupation. And that Roman occupation, that Roman leadership, you could say, is very clear and very present for everyone to see. Even though this is a very proud nation and they're very close connected to their land and all those things, and they have their own religion and all of that, they are under occupation. And it is very clear, very present, and something that they are dealing with. And as a result, on the ground, there's a bit of tension. There are new Jews and there are non-Jews. And there are also non-Jews who are Gentiles, most firmly represented, you could say, by the Roman people. Jesus, of course, was born a Jew, and he is stirring up the locals, you could say, in signs and wonders by this young Jewish man, words of wisdom. There's many who believe that this, or are starting to believe that this man is special. Is he a prophet? Is he divine even? But as the Gentiles, as onlookers, or even the Romans as onlookers, observe all this, you can imagine that they should be probably a bit more sceptical of Jesus. Maybe along the lines of what we maybe think about when we think about Pontius Pilate before Jesus was crucified. Remember, he was sort of more inquisitive about Jesus. What has this man got to say with himself? What is all this fuss about? And he asked him these questions as if intrigued by this phenomenon. In a place like Capernaum, they would have had plenty of Gentiles, plenty of non-Jews, a mix between Jew and non-Jew. And as I say, Gentiles probably most officially represented by the Roman army. And they would have looked on, you would suspect, with rolling their eyes a wee bit. It's much easier to think that Gentiles, who are not steeped in the Old Testament prophecies, would not be triggered as much about this Jesus and who he might be. You could trust these non-Jews with a more critical eye. And a centurion as well was no monk. A centurion was generally a clever person. You know, he must have had brains. He had to manage and lead a team of other Romans, probably. They would talk about this hundred figure of having these 100 men under him. But no doubt he also had a key role of keeping the peace in the area and policing these Jew and non-Jewish peoples. But this is not the skeptic that we might imagine we receive in this man. Far from it. You might think, well, maybe he's just a bit over-compassionate, given the fact that he has someone that he cares for who might be desperately sick. He might be desperate himself. The servant is highly favoured. But this was still a servant. And this was still a culture in which there was a hierarchy. This wasn't his own son. You know that, like, an own family member, when we think about Jairus, the synagogue leader, who went to Jesus in desperation because his daughter needed healed, in Mark 5. So I don't lean towards this desperation side of this Roman centurion. I instead lean towards what is a shrewd Gentile leader reaching out in faith, reaching out in belief, against all the odds. And he's reaching across a couple of different barriers here. He's reaching across the idea that there's a servant below him in the hierarchy, and he's also reaching across a religious barrier too. Not someone who is desperate to try anything to heal a person, but someone in his heart who believed, and believed enough to reach across these barriers. Now there's even some pleading done on his behalf. We see, for the centurion, on his behalf, on the side of the centurion, these elders of the Jews go to Jesus and plead on his behalf. That's striking, that this man, this Gentile, Roman centurion, has Jewish elders who respect him enough to plead on his behalf. We basically get really strong vibes that this is just a good guy. He's a good boss. He seems like a good person who cares and looks out for his community. Obviously a good boss, but also a good member of his community, accepted by his community. And maybe Luke is trying to get this message across that there were good Gentiles who were well integrated in society and actually were blessing others by the lives that they led. Verse 4, and when they came to Jesus, they pleaded with him earnestly. When I read earnestly, I think truthfully, from the heart. They weren't doing this out of duty. They were pleading because they believed in what they were saying. They pleaded with him earnestly, saying, he is worthy to have you do this for him, for he loves our nation. They're pleading with Jesus. They feel that it's the right thing to do. They're maybe pleading on the wrong grounds, maybe, because they're pleading on this man's merits, something we might be tempted to do. for he loves his nation. Clear they're talking about the centurion, not the servant, for he loves his nation, and he is the one who built us our synagogue. So this must have been a good boss, good to his servants, and a good person in the community, good to his people, cutting across the status levels and cutting across the religious boundaries too, and doing so, it seems, with love, with care, with compassion. So Luke is trying to let the reader know that there were and are good Gentiles present in this area, willing to do good to the people around them and be a positive impact in the society they're in. And the very fact then that he was willing to go to Jesus for help, for just one of his servants, was again evidence that he must have been a boss who loved his servant, cared for his servant, had concern for his servant, didn't treat them with contempt, which might have been normal in those society structures. We could all identify, I'm sure, with a good boss and a bad boss. We've all had one of those, I'm sure. A good line manager or a bad line manager. We've all had them. What does a good boss feel like? Well, I feel like that good boss cares about me. He doesn't just care about the product or the work that we're doing. He cares about me. When we have a good boss, we tend to respond with loyalty, don't we? If we have a bad boss, we maybe do the minimum for them, isn't that right? We don't really go out of our way for a bad boss. So we have a good boss, a Gentile boss, a good contributor to his community, he's wanting to do a good and a compassionate thing for his employee whom he cared for. And he's willing to cross these Gentile and Jewish barriers and status barriers and humbly go to Jesus for help. Where do we get humble? Where's the humility shown? Well, there in verse 6, Jesus went with them. So Jesus responds to these Jewish leaders coming, pleading on the Roman centurion's behalf, and then he decides to go to the centurion's home. Who knows how that would have went if he got the length, but he doesn't get the length. When he was not far, the centurion mustn't have intended for Jesus to come in person. He's maybe used to, as these leaders, with other leaders, they send others to send messages, and they're not hot-footing it around. When he saw or heard that Jesus was coming in his direction, then he was sort of humbled and embarrassed by that. And he sent his friends. Note, he sent his friends this time, not the Jewish elders or any of his servants, his friends, to meet him. Perhaps to make the message really crystal clear, trusting his close friends. He sent them. Lord. Starts off well there. Humble title. Lord, do not trouble yourself. There's no entitlement here for this Jewish centurion. Do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. This is humble. But there's also one leader recognizing and acknowledging another leader with humility. Now, working through communicating with others through servants was very common with leaders. No telephones, no conference calls. They had to, otherwise they'd be spending all their time backwards and forwards. Though they relied on runners, relied on ferry messengers, messages to be ferried and communication. Verse 7, therefore I did not presume to come to you, but say the word, Jesus, and let my servant be healed. For I too am a man set under authority with soldiers under me, and I say to one, go, and he goes, to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him. Marveled at him, the centurion. Amazed, I think, is in the version in front of you. And turning to the crowd that followed him, said, I tell you, Even in Israel have I found such faith. Not even in Israel have I found such faith. And when those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the servant well. So Jesus, it seems, doesn't get the length to even meet this chap. That's humility in a way. If you're a centurion and you think you're pretty important and special, you think that you're well placed to meet these characters, but he doesn't even want them near him. He humbles himself. Don't be coming all the way for me. Don't be stooping to come to my home. Just you do it, Jesus, from afar. You can do it. I know you're a leader. People follow you. Don't waste too much time with me and do what you can do from a distance and be on your way. That's humility and that's belief. Again, we notice in Luke, the Gospel of Luke, humility, humility, humility. We have the humility of Mary accepting what God asked of her. And we have humility here, bowing before Christ, humbling themselves before Christ, knowing compassion and mercy. Do you understand these things in your life? Compassion, mercy, humbling yourself. When you do, when you know the compassion, the mercy, the love of Jesus, the one who humbled himself for us, when you know that in your life, when you know that, you are changed. Humility. Realizing that my works are, don't do it. I need someone else. I need help. I need Jesus. Thankfulness is woven into all that, recognizing that you're just surrounded by blessings through your life. I need someone else. I need help. I need Jesus. I already rely on so much from God just to be standing here breathing before you. But the faith he displays, the belief, which is the how the centurion is remembered in many ways, is what comes through and is the thing that amazes Jesus. I believe this Jesus is who the people are saying he is. This centurion is saying, I'm going to trust Jesus. I'm going to go to him. I'm going to be humble enough to admit that I need him. I'm going to be humble enough to admit that I need him. Am I humble enough to admit that I need him? Note here, Jesus marvels. What does he marvel at? Well, he doesn't marvel at the fact that the centurion is a good lad. He's a good boss. He's a good community worker. He built a synagogue. He's good to the Jewish people. He doesn't marvel at that. He marvels at his belief. Jesus marveled at his faith. He was amazed, the NIV puts it. The only other time we are told Jesus was amazed at anything was in Mark 6. Verse 6, he's in his own town, hometown of Nazareth, and he's amazed at their lack of faith. Our faith is the thing, and I've said this before, our faith is the thing that is in us that we can amaze, we can marvel. Even Jesus. Jesus is certainly impacted by people's faith. We see that time and time again. He heals the paralyzed man. And we're told when Jesus saw their faith, that's when he did that in Matthew 9. In the same chapter, he heals the woman bleeding for 12 years. He said, your faith has healed you. Time and time again, it is our faith. It is our faith that moves the needle. It does the business. Moves the spiritual needle. Moves the heavenly needle that stands out in heaven in some shape or form. In closing, this Roman centurion was displaying good attributes. You could say Christian values. You can see that in how he treated his servants, how he treated the people around him, and we can be intrigued by that. We can think about Micah 6:8, walk, you know, act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. This guy was acting justly, and he was seemed to love mercy, and he seemed to be on the journey to walking with God. He may have only been at the beginning of his walk with God, but my goodness, this is a good start. It was a genuine, demonstrable faith that did it for Jesus. It needs to be our genuine, demonstrable faith that does it for us. This Roman centurion is a wonderful example of how we should treat people who we work alongside, and also how we should treat other cultures who we could very easily be suspicious of or look down upon. And that is pleasing to God. And look, what did they put that across and show that to the reader? This Gentile, this non-Jew, was doing a thing and even the ones around him maybe weren't doing. But it is this man's faith that moves Jesus, that amazes him. And then he instantly heals the servant. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your word. We thank you again for the Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that for this example that shows us, that points towards what it is to be in our society, in our workplace. But Lord, we need to have that faith, that trust, that stepping out in humility, putting our hands up. Just yesterday at this youth event I was at, there was many young people putting up their hands saying, I need help. I'm struggling. I need Jesus. You might look at that and think, oh, they're young. But really, they're humble enough. They're willing to admit their need of you. Lord, help none of us in this building be held back by our pride, by our value in ourselves that gets in the way of meeting you. Help us have that genuine faith, that genuine belief that stands out to Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. I'll leave my fruit back in place. Folks, let's continue in an attitude of prayerfulness. Again, with thankfulness at the center. Our response to Lord of the harvest is, hear our prayer. Lord of the harvest,
hear our prayer.
Our God, you promised to Noah that while earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. Lord, we give thanks for our daily bread. And we pray for all who work in industry, on farms, on the high seas. We ask for your blessing upon them, upon their work. And we pray, Lord, that all may enjoy the fruit of their labor. Lord of the harvest,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, who has given us such a diverse and beautiful world to live in, you have given us so much, and when we look to it, it's so obvious, Lord, that we are blessed. Lord, help us and give us wisdom in how we treat this beautiful world that you've given us. Give us respect for animals. Help us to prosper without polluting. Teach us, Lord, to be gentle with this earth you have given us and on which our life depends. Lord of the harvest, hear our prayer. Lord, as our Creator, we ask that you make us more thankful for all that we have received in life. Help us be more content with what we have. When we look towards Eba and our brothers and sisters in Christ over there, we see a people who display contentment and display joy in the midst of such struggles. Help us learn from that, Lord. Help us have contentment with what we have. And help us be more generous to others from that place of thanksgiving and that place of contentment. Lord of the harvest, hear our prayer. Father God, while we know this is a beautiful world, we know that it is also broken in many ways. And we pray for the parts of the world that suffer the most, from drought and disasters, from war and oppression, from disease and pain. We get daily reminders in the news that this world is not working the way that you would want it to. We ask, Lord, that you strengthen those who suffer the most, maybe just by what spot in this world they were born on. We pray you're with those who suffer more than we, especially. Strengthen them with hope and with perseverance. Help them to turn to you in their lives. And bless all who can and do provide help for them. Lord of the harvest,
hear our prayer.
We close our prayers together now by praying the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer, beginning, Our Father who art in heaven. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We invite us to stand and sing our closing hymn together. O Lord my God, how great thou art. Let's stand.
Oh,
great. We need to be thankful for you in our journey in this life. We ask that you simply help us do that. Help us never lose sight of the blessings that you have given us and continue to bless us with. And from that place of thankfulness, may we do life, trusting and believing in Jesus as our Lord and Savior. As we do life in this way, may we shine out to others. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Thank you so much for coming along. Good to see so many of you with us today. I just want to say thank you to the choir for their wonderful singing and their hard work and practicing. And also again for those who decorate the church beautifully for today. We thank you so much for that. We think that the vegetables will probably be going to our freezer ministry so that we can bless both communities that way. But there will be other fruit as well be going out as gifts, as Patricia said. May the God of hope fill us with joy and peace and believing through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen.